It is, as Ada said, it was a UN interagency project on human trafficking. It's a project that's been going on since 2000 in the Greater Mekong region, so six countries including Thailand. It involves a number, yes, of six governments, 11 UN agencies on paper, as I wrote there, because in fact they were all in, thank God, five agencies, which is already a high number, more actively involved. International NGOs, and all under the convening power and accountability of the refugee community in Thailand, being extended without proper evaluation, proper review of the project document, the results of the project should have ended up a number of problems. So it would extend from 2009 to 2013, but around 2010, very different views of what this project should actually be doing start emerging from the different groups of stakeholders. And that's when the call for an independent evaluation starts kicking in. More, I must say, from the UN side of the group of stakeholders than the others, because I think there was an overall feeling that they were losing control of what was happening, what was the initial purpose of the project. So it was actually an interesting exercise in itself, convincing all the stakeholders there was actually needed an evaluation to begin with, and the thing that we really leveraged on, and in this sense I was sitting in the RC office, I was basically supporting the resident coordinating this chairing mode that she had vis-a-vis the project management board of UNIA. We really tried to leverage on the fact that it should have been independent, and that it's not a decision-making tool per se, but the fact that it would provide knowledge and evidence for the project to go to continue possibly with everybody on the same page and learning from past problems. Led them to agree that it was needed for the evaluation before, well, in the same meantime, extending the project, but at the same time, do an evaluation that would inform the extension period and also put the basis for the next phase of the project if such would advise by evaluation. A very participatory process in roughly the TOR of the evaluation itself. This is where we had the first, I think, interaction with UNEDA, and the colleagues and the evaluation group at the regional level here in America. But basically for the OTRI it took quite a long time because we were all back and forth, make sure that all the stakeholders were in sync with the purpose of the evaluation and the way it should have been carried out. Recruitment evaluator, and here that's where we had because it was such a charged environment, we purposely decided not to involve any of the stakeholders in the process, but just one group of stakeholders, which was the UN agencies, but not the program people, just evaluation experts. And with me in the function of evaluation manager to coordinate the process. And then the evaluation process came about for 6 months. It was one person evaluation, which I mean was quite an effort. Quite an intense exercise. Well, as I already said, the whole evaluation management structure was we had an evaluation management group which was coordinated by me and with members of UNEDA or agencies that were involved in the project. So namely Ada from the UNICEF side and from ILO. And then we had a UN sector specialist, so somebody that could bring in more the technical expertise, but I have some comments on that later on. We had evaluation, the huge evaluation report, evaluation update, and initial findings. They were shared and discussed at length with the evaluation management group, and Adam, I want to add to it at some point. The thing is also we purposely decided not to, after discussion, not to have an evaluation reference group, and the reason being because again of the such divergent and pretty entrenched views of what the project should be, and we wanted to stay away from it and look at it in a very independent way. Okay, challenger. I mean, I kind of tried to align there with some of the, you know, the keywords, what would have been for me the keywords that really characterize this process. And I tell you, it was extremely political, ethical issues. I mean, let's not forget also the subject matter is a pretty sensitive one. You're talking about human trafficking, a lot of people involved, a lot of cases involved, even though the project, okay, was dealing more to provide services to different group of stakeholders in the anti-trafficking community, still those involved in direct implementation of small project, and it was a very difficult relationship throughout the whole process, something that needed to be managed very carefully between me and the evaluator, and then touching base regularly with the evaluation management group, making sure that they were aware of the sensitivity that we were finding along the ways and how to deal with that in a ethical manner. There was a lot of pressure on all sides, from the government, from the donors, from the UN agencies themselves, and that had to be managed in a very careful way. There's a high number of stakeholders, competition over funding. Let's not forget that this is not a typical joint program in which UN agencies come in, get you know, each of them a part of the share of the pie and implement their parts jointly or individually. It was rather a project that was, as I said, run under the resident coordinator. They got fundings, and with these fundings, they were supposed to help and coordinate agencies concerned and in their work on anti-trafficking. But some of the UN agencies start seeing the project as a competitor itself, vis-a-vis the same pot of money basically that was available. So there was also that component that didn't help. As I said, a very unclear governance structure of the project that made everything a bit more complicated. And trying to viewpoint, I think I mentioned that already. The confidentiality, I said, was key, because really one thing that I think it was a bit of an eye-opener when the evaluator started telling us, you know, how things were going, and she was saying that people were scared to talk about how the project was going. So you can imagine what us as an evaluation management group, and me in particular as evaluation manager, how to deal with such a sensitive situation, at the same time make sure that these things would come out in a constructive manner and lay the ground for the way forward. It was basically a very unique situation, which I think would have needed to be uniquely managed, if you will. How we responded, I think partially already mentioned that as I was talking and mentioning different challenges. One thing, it was to ensure maximum transparency around the whole process, and especially at the end of the process when the findings were brought forward with all stakeholders, to ensure that there were access to all the same information. And the level of transparency went to the point that when the evaluator, when we finally sent out the draft evaluation to all the stakeholders, and people were invited, different stakeholders were invited to put back, you know, to write their comments and suggestions and feedback, all these were then shared with everybody with evaluators' responses. Again, raising a lot of problems in a sense, because some of the stakeholders were not happy seeing their own feedback and being made public, but I think that helped in putting all the cards on the table. Yes, I think it was very important. But at the same time, there needed to be balanced out with the confidentiality. So, for example, the draft findings were not shared with anybody apart from the evaluation management group, with a very clear understanding that was not to be shared, not even with the counterpart within the agency, before the actual project management board. So everybody could arrive to the project management board where the findings would have been first put forward that had the same level of information. And I think that was key not to derail the process. Again, as issues of maintaining a high degree of ethical standards, so ensuring the impartiality and independence of the whole evaluation process. And I'll tell you, it was not an easy task at all. And then, yes, trying to, as much as possible, and then really chapeau to the evaluator herself, who really made sure that every cases of especially sensitive findings would have been backed up by strong evidence. And of course, here we're talking mainly about qualitative assessments of people's sentiment about how the project was functioning, etc. So of course, it needed to be very carefully crafted. And that meant that a lot of attention on details, the way it was actually drafted, the whole document, the whole document, attention to the wording, the reference, the sources being lengthy back and forth and trying to make sure that we could back up every single calibration and the communication that was in the evaluation. So that was meant going back and forth. We look at the UN rules and regulation, code of conduct in UN staff. I mean, this level of details. The one called the liability for the project or RC, etc. So that was a very challenging result. But one thing that really came out at least of the evaluation was that the governance structure was finally changed of the project, made it much clearer. Now it's fairly placed the project under one agency, which makes it much clearer in terms of, at least from the UN perspective, but also for donors who know clearly where the responsibilities are. There's been a change in the project staffing. I mean, you might have noticed in one of the earlier slide, and I think one of the issues with that was that the staff of the project management unit itself was very much becoming like a stakeholder itself, in the sense that it was acting in the wrong way and being part of the problem, if you will. One thing that could have been better in terms of impact of evaluation, that in spite of the fact that the evaluation provided very clear recommendations on how the whole, especially for a new phase of the project, on how the different objectives should have been structured differently and creating different lines of reporting for different parts of the project. Because it's one part of the project that is basically providing secretariat support to the six governments. They have their own, yes, intergovernmental process on human trafficking, and it's a part that is more operational. So the sense that there should have been a firewall in that. That one has now really been taking place. There is a new project in place, which reflects, yes, some of the impact of the evaluation. Last but not least, what would have done differently? Okay. Would you choose a job? That was really an option, but frankly speaking, it's been kind of stressful and time-consuming exercise that if I go back, I would probably design before getting to the evaluation management group. For the impartiality of the evaluation management group, as I mentioned before, the fact that there was that one UN agency representative that was also basically a direct stakeholder into the project created issues on the perceived impartiality of the evaluation management group, so that I would have done better. Evidence, as I said before, but yet again, maybe we could have pushed the evaluator to be even more evidence-based. Well, some potential criticism could have been preempted, but that's part of the game, I guess. And then, yes, engage maybe more with the new management, especially because the part of them was shifted over to one specific UN agency, and maybe there could have been more engagement to ensure that the whole set of recommendations from the evaluation could have been
A very challenging evaluation, but has been influential at least to a certain extent. Questions, please, Krishna?
So one, you are saying all stakeholders, how many are you talking about when they review the TOR, the acceptance report, the first draft and all that, all the way to the recommendations, how many people are dealing with agencies? Different kinds. Secondly, at the end, towards the end, you said that among the recommendations, the operational aspects, they have been taken on board, the structure has changed and so on. Great. But you also said that the purpose of the program, project, and the objective remain the same. Did the evaluation say that they should remain the same, or was the evaluation silent about it?
Thank you very much. Any other question? Yes, please.
If you had to narrow down the main cause of the issues for this particular activity, would you say it was the design of the actual project, the actual activities, the actual outcomes, the outputs, the actual technical design, or was it more the actual interplay of individuals involved? If you had to choose one of those two, which would be your choice as to the main cause of the problem?
Any other question, comment? No questions, no comments?
Yeah, the number of stakeholders, as I said, was extremely high. We had six governments, five UN agencies, a handful of civil society organizations. I think that's, and well, and the donors. I mean, there were four main donors. And all of them, even though there was the project management board, was supposed to have, let's say, one representative of the donors on behalf of all the donors, and actually two on behalf of all the donors. The government initially should have been only a couple of governments on the management board to represent all the donors. At during that period I described, when issues start arising of different views vis-a-vis of what the project should have been designed for and should the way it should function, everybody wanted to be on the project management board. And the process that I described of, yes, the participatory process of drafting the TUR, it was everybody under the sun. So, yeah. And that's, I think, when we decided reference group, no way. I mean, it was impossible to find, frankly speaking, and I think can support me on that, it was impossible to find a group of stakeholders, I mean, selected stakeholders that could have a really detached and impartial view. It was so charged and so extreme views on the project, on the project implementation unit, that made it very difficult. Do you want
probably
to say something?
Yeah. Probably I can say something on that. I think that for us as an evaluation management group, at least, even for me, it was quite challenging to come to a conclusion that better not an evaluation reference group, because that's what we preach about, that's what we strive for. But we were facing challenges even individually, of people coming to us, either saying, well, this should not be evaluated, this is very delicate, or having people saying, you should speak out, you should be doing this, saying the other, telling this the other, etc. So there were, was possible to divide the stakeholders between those that wanted to speak out through us, in a way, and not directly, and the others asking us not to speak out about probably the same issues that were the hottest ones. And it was very, very difficult. It was very, very difficult throughout the process. It has been very time consuming in the way that we had to meet more frequently to discuss the strategies on how to go about, and also to read every single thing line by line to make sure that we are going the right way. So it was a very tough conclusion too, but it was the conclusion we had to come about, being transparent, making sure that everybody gets the information, that everybody has the right to comment, but we didn't have one to create a group that probably will not be able to reach consensus at any level, and we would put the pressure to us on one way or the other on how to go about with the evaluation.
Thank you, Anaya. On the objectives, if they remain the same, and what was the recommendations of the evaluation? As I said, the recommendations of the evaluation in terms of the substance of the program, I think the biggest challenge of the project, which I think we kind of knew from the beginning, but became very clear, and especially in the evaluation, became very clear that the governance structure was the main challenge. But not only that, I think it brought to the surface what has been the consequences of these governance structures, which were quite frightening, if I may use that word. So in terms of the objective itself, it was the recommendations were, as I hinted to, was on one side to delink them, because there was this web, I mean, of the way the project was implemented and managed. It was done in such a way that each objective, I mean, could not survive without the other, which in normal situation might be actually maybe a good thing, but in this case was very complicated, because one objective, a specific objective was to provide support to this intergovernmental process, which is called COMET, which is basically an interministerial process of these six countries in which they commit themselves to do certain things to combat human trafficking in the region. And this UNIA provided secretariat support to this project, to this process. And at the same time, they were doing other work, which at some point it was becoming a bit, how can I say, active, I mean, in a way, it was the perception by some countries that they were using, well, one country specific, they were using this project and their access to the government to feed in information about what was happening in the country, the anti-trafficking, to a specific donor, to put it very bluntly. So you can find the evaluator said very clearly, these two things need to be completely linked and needs to be made very clear. And it's also a sustainability issue, because the secretariat support sooner or later had to be removed and made sustainable. So the government should take eventually ownership and responsibility for the process itself. So it needed to be, the project needed to be structured in such a way that this stream of the project could become eventually independent and delinked. And now it would have been impossible in the way it was managed. So that was a strong recommendation there. The other objective that the evaluator suggested, if not to eliminate it, to review substantially, was the whole ambition that the project had to be a coordinator of the UN agencies working in that area, which, okay, for those of us who work in the coordination system, we know already how difficult it is to coordinate agencies when you have a mandate for it and when you sit under a resident coordinator chapeau. Can you imagine for a project to actually being able to play that function? I mean, it was very difficult and everybody was unhappy. The project was unhappy about it because they didn't have that, obviously, that convening power and that authority to play that role. The agencies were unhappy because they felt that the project wasn't playing the role. I mean, it's, so the suggestion of the evaluator was like, just drop it, forget about it. It is an ambition that is not. Of course, you have to coordinate as you have to coordinate with any, you know, kind of project, especially if it's interdisciplinary in nature. But still, so yes, that was the recommendation. The objective didn't remain exactly the same, but from my point of view, there wasn't that. In clear division between the different objectives that was recommended, which I still think was needed. And there's still this emphasis on the coordination, which, from my perspective, having gone through the evaluation process, I still think that it's not sustainable.
Well, I think we have four excellent presentations. We have had very interesting discussions. So I think we made it.